and she gets a request. A man comes in, he's hungry. A prophet, she knows of the prophet. She knows him to be Elijah. And he says, make me a little cake first. Man, what? How unreasonable can you be? But her obedience saved her life. Her obedience changed the direction and the course of her life. Turn with us to 1 Kings chapter 17, verse 10. 1 Kings chapter 17 and verse 10. Amen. We're going to begin reading. Verse 10 says, so he arose and went to Zarephath. And when he came to the gate of the city, behold, the widow woman was there gathering of sticks. And he called to her and said, fetch me, I pray thee, a little water in a vessel that I may drink. And as she was going to fetch it, he called to her and said, bring me, I pray thee, a morsel of bread in your hand. And she said, as the Lord thy God liveth, I do not have a cake, but I just have a handful of meal and a barrel. I got a little bit of oil and a cruse. And behold, I'm gathering two sticks that I may go in and dress it for me and my son that we may eat it and then die. And Elijah said unto her, fear not. Go and do as thou hast said. But make me thereof a little cake first, and bring it unto me, and afterward make for you and your son. Amen. That line says it all. Make me a little cake first. That's the whole sermon. Make me a little cake first. There's not a wasted word. There's a spiritual lesson for all generations. There was a great bonus when this woman heeded and obeyed the word of God. And there is a great bonus for us to win again and again and again. Let me tell you the story. God had rightly, he had decreed judgment upon Israel because they were worshiping the prophets of Baal. They, amazing as that might sound, they had Jezebel, Ahab, one of the worst kings in Israel's history. They had set up the 450 prophets of Baal and the groves and all of this and set up high. And God said, it will not rain in Israel again until Elijah says it will rain. And if you read the story, Ahab sent to all the other countries. He said, hey, is Elijah there? He made them swear. They had to swear an oath. They said, no, we can't find him. He's not here. He was searching everywhere for Elijah. We call it a drought here when it doesn't rain for a few weeks. You know this fall it went like 6 weeks without raining. We said, we're in a drought. Everything, we're all drinking water, eating, having a big time. Said, man, we're in a drought. We don't know drought. It didn't rain a whole year. It didn't rain for 2 years. The ground, you heard of the dust bowls out in Oklahoma in the 30s when it was just dusty all around them. The dust, the farmers, they didn't have any crops. There was no rain. There was no water. Ahab sent soldiers around the kingdom to look for a pool of water so his horses could drink and not die. Now that's really, really bad when you're searching so your horses will not die. It was desperate condition. This woman prepares, can you see it? If you could picture it, she prepares a little handful of meal. Everything's gone. The godly are suffering with the ungodly. Remember that. The godly suffer along with. She prepares a little handful of meal, and she prepares to eat this and to heroically face the inevitable. She receives a request that she believes to be totally unreasonable. She needed the food. Her son, she said, we're going to eat this and then we're just going to die. And she gets a request. A man comes in, he's hungry. A prophet, she knows of the prophet. She knows him to be Elijah. And he says, make me a little cake first. Man. What? How unreasonable can you be? But her obedience saved her life. Her obedience changed the direction and the course of her life. It was a great change for her. Well, first, let's look at the story. Elijah asked for cake. He asked for cake. He said, give me a little cake. That's what he's talking about. A little cake first. He could have asked her for some venison. He could have said, man, he said, I tasted Brother Larry's venison last Sunday night. Woo, it was good. Venison. She could have said, I can't do that. I don't have any venison. He could ask her for some fish. He said, could you fix me a beautiful fish? She could have said, I can't do that. He could have said, what about an apple? A big, juicy apple. Oh, it sounds so good. She could have said, I can't do that. I don't have any fruit. What did he ask her for? He asked her for what she had. She could not say no. She could not say nothing was required except simple obedience. She couldn't refuse. It was within her power and her ability. He said, just give me what you have. Oh man, the excuses she could have made. I'm not going to go into it. She could have said, look, this is not fair. I'm about to eat this and we're going to die. And you want to take my son, you want to take our last meal away from us? That's not right. That's not fair. We're not going to do that. She could have gone on and on. She could have talked about God's judgment on the nation and the wicked people and all of the things. She could have talked about everything. But it goes to show, she could not say, I cannot do it. It was within her ability. God asks you to do what is possible. So many people refuse the call of God on the grounds of inability. God never asks us to do what we cannot do. He never does. He doesn't. Matthew 25, verses 24 and 25. You see it, they've got it there on the screen. He said, I know you are a hard man. You reap where you hadn't sowed. You gather where you hadn't strawed. And I was afraid, and I did not invest your money, and here it is back. What was the key? I did not invest your money because I was afraid. Fear kept him from this little woman could have said, I'm just afraid because everybody, neighbor, is starving. And you know, God doesn't do that. God won't ask you to teach a class in Hebrew. He won't ask you to teach a class in Hebrew. He won't ask you to be a medical missionary. He won't. If you're not medically trained, He's not going to ask you to do that. He's not going to ask you to be a Supreme Court justice. Unless you're a renowned attorney and you've been appointed to jobs, He's not going to ask you to preach huge crusades. He won't ask you to do that. God only asks you to do what is in your power and what you can do. Praise the Lord. God asks you to love Him. He says, love me. Love me. Love me with all your heart. Love me with all your mind. Love me with all your soul. A lot of us love our television sets. We can't wait on Monday night to get home, but we got to be there and have dinner and clean up the dishes and be ready for whatever comes on Monday night. What is it, Scorpion or something, whatever? Geniuses? That's a real commonplace thing, isn't it? We love our jobs. We love our careers. We love hunting. We've got hunters here. We love fishing. We have some fishermen here. We have people who love these things. They love it. And those are all fine. But God asked Peter, do you love me more than these? Do you love me more than you love your job? More than you love your career? More than you love hunting? More than you love fishing? More than you love any of these things? Do you love me more than these things? Only you can answer this question. See, it's a matter of priority. It's a matter of priority. Are you going to put God last? Well, God, we worked our budget and I paid every bill. There's only $4.22 left over, but I'll give that to... No, it's a matter of priority. It's a matter of saying, Lord, what is Matthew 6:33, I believe it is. I hope that's the right. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all these other things shall be added unto you without you having to target them, without going after them. They will be added unto you. That's God's word. To love others, to love your spouse. I'll say that again. To love your spouse. To love your spouse. To be faithful to the church. To be faithful to your place of ministry. To witness. To share. To share the heart of Christ. To trust. He says, trust in me. You trust your body to the doctor. You trust your mail to the post office. You trust all these things. He says, trust in me. He says, trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not to your own understanding, and He shall direct your path. He will lead you in the ways of prosperity and blessing and goodness. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. They're going to chase me down. It doesn't matter where I go. Goodness and mercy are going to chase me down. They're going to jump on my back. I may say, whoa, but there's goodness and mercy following me. Praise the Lord. God is going to bless you. He says, repent of your sin. What does that mean? It means change direction. Put your sin away. Go the other direction. It means to weep and cry and to confess, Lord, I am a sinner. Help me. Forgive my sins and come into my life. God asks us to do these things. Now, secondly, he said, make me a little cake. I want you to focus on the word little. Make me a little cake. God is not greedy. He's not. Hale has been selling a doctrine that God is greedy. His request was measured by the size of her possessions. He could have said, I would love to have a steak. She would say, I don't have a steak. I don't have a baked potato. I don't have a salad. I don't have anything. He said, make me a little cake first. Hell, heaven's not greedy. What about a dollar bill? It says in tithing, he says, bring ye into the storehouse so that there will be meat in my house. In Proverbs 3, 9 and 10, he says, honor the Lord with the first fruits so that your barns will be full. Hey, out of a dollar bill, what's 10%? 10 cents. 10 cents. He says, spend the other 90 any way you want to, but give me the first 10%. Did you know that 90% will spend about $4 worth when you give the first 10 cents to God? Amen. Let's give the Lord a clap offering. Praise the Lord. 10 cents. You make $1,000, $100. You make $5,000, everybody from the kid with an allowance. You know what? That made me think. We need to teach our kids to tithe. We need to teach our kids to tithe. When I got an allowance, man, back then it was small. I cut a whole yards and I'd get $2. And I'd spend hours cutting them. But you know what? 20% went to the Lord. We need to teach our children by our example and by instruction. We need to teach them to tithe unto the living God. What about our time? Whoa, wait a minute. Wait a minute. I don't have any extra time. He says, give me 10% of your time first. 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 But I work 6 days a week, and I'm so tired on Sunday, Pastor. I just have to have a day of rest. You're going to need to rest if you don't go to church. You're going to be tired, dragging, defeated. You go to God's house. You go worship the Lord. You praise. You give unto Him. You'll be a new man the next day. Praise the Lord. Oh, you're going to be dragging. If you stay home, you come to church, you are going to be good to go. What about the prodigal son? He wanted it all. His attitude was, give me what's mine. Give me my inheritance. Is that the attitude of the world? Selfish? Greedy? Oh, you're not going to get any more. You better hold on to that. Don't let any of it get away. That's not God's economy. God's economy is giving. Giving. He says, give so it can be given back to you so you can give more, and then you get it back and you give it more, and God blesses you. Bless the Lord. The Lord. The Lord. some may have so little to give. Matthew chapter 20, verse 6 says some came in the 11th hour and they worked just a little while, but when it came time to get paid, they got full payment. And Jesus said, the guy said, wait a minute, we worked all day. They only worked an hour. They got full payment. God says, give, and it shall be given back to you. It's never too late. It's never too late. Hell tells you it's too late. It says, well, oh man, you've waited too late. You got so little. Man, you got such a little bitty amount. And God's never going to miss that. You're on Social Security. You only get $1,400 a month. He's never going to miss your $140. Let me tell you something. God does not ask for your tithe because He needs it. He asks for your tithe so you can be blessed and get a blessing from God. Amen. God doesn't need your $140 a month. He owns a cattle on 1,000 hills. He is the source of every blessing. He gives unto you so you can give unto somebody else. He blesses you. Thirdly, quickly, He said, give me a little cake first. Look at that word, first. She could have said, wait a minute, wait a minute. We're going to make a little cake. We're going to make a little cake, and then whatever's left over, we're going to give it to you. And that's very reasonable. You know, people say, Pastor, I've got a lot of medical bills. I can't really afford to tithe. Or, Pastor, I've got a lot of credit cards. Credit cards, those bills, they just keep pestering me. You don't want to tithe? You're going to drown in debt. You're going to drown in debt. You want to get out of debt? Begin to tithe and trust God for a miracle. God's plan is for you to get out of debt. God must be first. He says it in Proverbs 3, 9, and 10, I believe. He said, honor me with the first fruits. Honor me with the first fruits. This is your way. He says, honor the Lord with thy substance and with the first fruits out of all of your income, and I will pour out new wine unto you. The victory is won when we submit to God, when selfishness is vanquished, when we surrender to God, when we give to Him. Give mercy first, give our time first, give our life first. And we must surrender unto God. There's so many things I could tell. So many things. True stories. If my mother doesn't mind me telling another story. When my grandparents lived in a house car with two children. Don't ask me what a house car is. I'll tell you later. They lived in a house car. Two kids. They were in Columbus at one of the highlands or something over there. And they had nothing to eat. Had nothing to eat. They had a saltine cracker box. She came out and she looked at George and Maydell. They were playing. She got two pieces of loaf bread out, gave one to each of them, said, don't come back and ask for anything else. There's not anything. And they went off that day to play. They didn't know any different. Mama and Papa Crawford didn't have anything to eat. That night they were in church. Mama Crawford saw a lady staring at her. She wasn't Mama Crawford, went in the choir. The lady was staring at her. Finally the lady went. Mama Crawford went. She said, she went down on the back on the choir loft. The lady said, do you live in some kind of a contraption, some kind of thing? And Mama Crawford said, yeah. She said, "Did you give your kids saltine crackers?" She said, "Well, no, it was bread, but it was in a saltine cracker box." She said, "Did you have anything to eat today?" Mama Crawford said, "Well, no, we didn't." She said, "Oh, the Lord showed me your house car, showed me you giving your kids some saltine crackers or something. The Lord told me to fix lunch for y'all." And I said, "I don't know those people. I'm not going to fix lunch for them. And here you are tonight, and you're right here, and it's all true. And would you come home with me tonight? I'm going to fix you the biggest feast you have ever had." She fixed them a Thanksgiving feast. Then she packed up food and sent it home with them and gave them food to eat. That is the blessings of God feeding Elijah by the brook with the ravens. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. I could tell you many others. But to close it, God provides, fourthly, in His own way, in His own manner, in His own time. You know the widow woman? You know what she would have liked? She'd like to have had a whole barn full of food. She could go out there anytime. Ooh, she would have felt better. Thank you, Jesus. A whole barn. I can invite a friend over sometime for dinner. Or what about just a pantry? She could have gone in there and got stuff anytime she needed it. But you know what? God didn't give her a barn. God didn't give her a pantry. God didn't give her any of that stuff. The only thing He gave her was a meal barrel. And every day she would go out and she would look in that meal barrel. You know what? That'd be enough for a cake of cornbread. She'd scrape it out. She'd bake a cake of cornbread. The next morning, she'd go out and look. What? There's enough for another cake of cornbread. You see, God, she would have loved security. She would have loved, "Oh, I want to have it in the bank, God. So anytime anything happens, I can write a check." God said, "Trust me, trust me, trust me in your lack to provide your need, to provide exactly what you need." God's provision for today is God's guarantee for tomorrow. Have faith in God.